Hi there, I'm here with Dennis McKenna. He's a famed psychedelic enthusiast and academic, the brother of Terence McKenna, a wild psychedelic philosopher, quite famous in the 90s. So we're going to sit and talk about a whole lot of different things, including a number of organizations that Dennis is part of that are great, the Hefter Institute and the Ayahuasca Project and things like that. And we'll talk about his new book, Brotherhood of the Screaming Abyss, and many other very interesting topics. So very glad to talk to you again, Dennis. Hi, how are you going?
It's great to be here, Amadeus.
Good.
Thanks
good.
For inviting me, and I'm sorry it took so long to arrange this, but here we are, so we'll make the best of it.
Exactly. No problem at all. So, yeah, I mean, let's start with Brotherhood of the Screaming Abyss. I mean, that's sort of the topic of the moment for you. It's come out a couple of months ago, and you've been...
It's been out since the end of November. Well, since early December, really.
There we go. Five, 6 months.
A few months.
So you've been traveling and speaking about that in various places, and you know, I'm sure you get the same questions over and over. But if you could just give us a little bit of a rundown of the trajectory of the book and how it's written.
Sure.
Cool.
Well, any chance to flog the book, I'm always happy to
sure.
take that. but it is basically the story of my life with Terence, growing up with Terence, and our adventures, our shared interests. You know, we were both, got interested in psychedelics early on, and that really was the thing that formed the sort of continuing carrot that led us, that still leads us, really. We're preoccupied with those concerns since the early 70s. As a matter of fact, I was just writing Rack Razam, who's known to you, had asked me to write an introduction to the reissuance of his own book here. I should be showing my book here, but this so it's forced me to reflect, and I found my introduction is turning out to be a sort of a recap of how we got into this. You know, how did this ayahuasca tourism thing get started? And I have to say, not really taking credit for it, but I have to say some of Terence's and I early visits to the Amazon were kind of the catalyst to that.
Sure.
And, people are more familiar with his side of the story than mine because he's been all over the net for years. He wrote True Hallucinations, and together we wrote The Invisible Landscape, which is now, you know, very old. But I just felt a compulsion to kind of tell my side of the story, and I did. And that's what the Brotherhood of the Screaming Abyss is about. The name is kind of tongue-in-cheek. Because when we went to the Amazon in 1971, you know, we knew we were after something incredible. We had no idea what we were really after. We were so naive and so clueless, really. But we knew it was had to be good, and it was sort of this heart of darkness idea. And that was my brother's catchphrase for it. You know, we are the Brotherhood of the Screaming Abyss.
Right. Just diving right in.
That's how it came about, you know.
Yeah.
And I think that harkens back to Lovecraft, really. I mean, he was into that kind of thing, too. So,
it wasn't, as most of his characters were just diving right into the heart of darkness, as it were.
Right.
And so
the book has been, you know, pretty well received generally.
Yeah.
A lot of good feedback on it. So I'm happy.
Well, I think a lot of people would be very interested in hearing your side, in as much as you are obviously the more academic of the two brothers. You know, you've got your doctorate and stayed on that path more or less, you know, publishing and doing research. So I think probably hearing it from that perspective is probably very good for a lot of people who are getting into psychedelics contemporarily, because there is this big resurgence of psychedelic science as opposed to psychedelic philosophy, and people are using that as a way to kind of, you know, get in the cultural cracks and, you know, carve out a niche for this sort of thing and overturn some of the bad press of the 60s. And, you know, I think this will probably be a pretty big notch in that, you know, where you've got someone who's a scientist, but they've also had kind of the most extreme out there experiences as well, the kind of, you know, conceptually extreme experiences as well, giving an overview of, you know, a lifetime of experience with this stuff, and with somebody like Terence, who was so widely received in his time, and still, you know, he still is very well received. Okay, so so that's what the book's about. So for anyone listening, go and find that and get a copy of it for yourself. And
well, please do.
Everyone else, you know.
Order it from, I don't know if you can order from Amazon.com in Australia.
Yeah, we can. Yeah.
That's the easiest way to do it, if you can. Otherwise, order from my website, which is called the Brotherhood of the, it's called Brotherhood of the Screaming Abyss.com. Without the, but you can order from either website. Right, yeah, so enough plugs, I guess.
Yeah, well, I was going to say, since we're doing this, if you want to say a few words about the Hefter Institute or the Ayahuasca Project or anything like that, feel free.
Well, certainly in the context makes sense. Your mentioning of the psychedelic science, and the resurgence of psychedelic science, it's really quite remarkable, and you're probably aware of the recent Psychedelic Science 2013 conference that was held in Oakland, most in April. Most in our community are aware of that, and that was really they call it the MAPS conference, and MAPS was another one of these organizations, very good work, multidisciplinary association for psychedelic studies, organized it and did really the heavy lifting on it. But the Hefter was a sponsor, the Hefter Research Institute that I'm affiliated with, the Beckley Foundation, the Council on Spiritual Practices, other organizations, and it was actually an amazing conference. You know, I was there, of course, and there were 2,000 people attending conference.
It's a big crowd. It's a big crowd.
And we took over the Oakland Convention Center for 4 days, and it was not your usual, you know, button-down crowd. I mean, it was a colorful crowd. But it was really, you know, I mean, it was very gratifying. It was a real scientific conference, you know. This wasn't just a bunch of hippies getting together saying, why can't we do research? You know, this was people, we're doing the research and we're here to talk about it. And there's some very interesting things going on. So I was very gratified. I think this is going to change a lot of things if the momentum is not lost. You know, I think it's going to change neuroscience and biomedicine, and particularly psychiatry, and you know, and possibly the legal framework. I mean, it's just ridiculous that these substances are, you know, banned and considered dangerous substances with no possible chemical or no possible medical use or therapeutic use. It's just absurd. And the evidence that they do have uses was abundant out there at the conference. So what we need to do is build on that and change the conversation. You know, we need to let the hysteria of the 60s go and just take a more sober look at it and say, figure out, well, how do these things fit in to our culture? And how is that going to change our culture? And you know, I mean, all the usual things that are brought up. How do we minimize the harm and maximize the benefit? And so it sounds, you know, it's nothing radical to say that.
It's, you know, as you mentioned, there's a number of areas of science that psychedelic studies are really putting pressure on at the moment, you know, and the biggest one has been psychiatry, you know, the studies that Roland Griffith's done and Johns Hopkins and a couple of others. I mean, they seem to be the most sort of wow places. But another place of pressure for psychedelic science that I find very interesting that you might want to talk about for a few minutes is in the treatment of addiction and the treatment of trauma, PTSD, this sort of thing. And I've heard that there's about 12 or 15 studies going on at the moment with the use of MDMA on PTSD symptoms.
That's right. MDMA is very promising for that. And that is an area that MAPS has kind of staked out. You know, I mean, nobody owns MDMA, but they've really taken the lead in exploring that. And ultimately, their agenda is to have MDMA rescheduled to at least Schedule 2 so that it can be prescribed by therapists and used by therapists. And I think they're going to succeed. I mean, you know, they're going to succeed. There's a certain momentum that's developed. They've got the Pentagon is now interested in this. The Pentagon is talking to them. Of course, we have a huge problem with PTSD in vets, and they're very practical about it. You know, it's like, if this stuff works, then, you know, we're interested. So that's a very encouraging conversation, and I think that ultimately that's gonna bring it around. And why not? And you know, there are other substances too, of course, that can be used for PTSD, including psilocybin, which is kind of the substance that the Hefters, you know, tied its hopes to. And ayahuasca, as you know, ayahuasca is harder to research in a clinical context, but that too is very promising. And I think over the next 5 years, you're going to see a change. And I think that therapists are going to, you know, have access to these substances and be able to use them if they want to. And you know, and once that climate is created, I think that the results will come in. People will see that they do work. They'll see that they're not dangerous. This isn't about tripping out or recreational use, and they will be accepted. And, you know, my concern is that, I expect the real, you know, the real pushback is going to come from the pharmaceutical industry.
Right, yeah.
Which is basically seeing their whole thing, they view this as a threat because, you know, they've spent billions to develop all of these psychotropic drugs to treat every kind of condition, and they don't work very well, and they're harmful, and they're just Band-Aids, you know. They don't really get to the bottom of things. But they have a lot of power, a lot of clout in Washington because they have so much money, and there's going to be a lot of pushback on that.
I think there probably is, you know, when you can just walk down the road and pick some mushrooms at the right time of year instead of forking out a lot of money to a big pharma company, you know, to for instance, affect anxiety disorders or something like that, where, you know, that's a huge industry in the U.S.
Or even to just have a therapeutic session where, you know, one or two or three sessions and you pretty much resolve your problem rather than have to take a drug for the rest of your life, you know, which suits their agenda very well. And the other thing is these things are not really, there's not a lot of money to be made in them is what the bottom line is. They're not patentable, really. Right. Some of the analogs might be, but we'll just see how it plays out. I mean, you know, we complain a lot about the government, you know, in our country, and there's a lot of dissatisfaction. But there are aspects of elements of the government that you know, are forces for good in this controversy, like sure. the FDA, actually. The FDA is supposedly non-political. Nobody really believes that, but they do believe in science, you know. Right. And if you can bring evidence forward that these things have an effect that's therapeutic, they'll approve a study, and they have approved many sure. studies, and yeah. they just try to look at the science. And so these studies are in progress now, and the outcomes are quite impressive. Just yeah. for one example, there's one of Roland Griffith's postdocs, one of his, I guess he's a physician, but he's essentially a postdoc, Matthew Baggett, Matthew Johnson, has got a protocol underway using psilocybin to treat smoking okay. cessation, tobacco addiction. Very, very small pilot study. I think they're only screening like 15 people.
Right.
It's a crossover study. So far, 100% response. Mm. In other words, after two sessions and plenty of therapy leading up to it and plenty of yeah. conditioning and talking and all that, but after two sessions, all of their subjects so far have been able to simply stop smoking right. for at least the 6 months, you know, follow-up yeah. period. Yeah. And that's so incredible. That's pretty incredible.
Yeah. And that's, you know, that's something that, you know, if this is hard something that's ignore. Repeatable, you know, if this is something yeah. that's repeatable, it's huge.
So yeah, the whole world is going to want to know about this. So. You can't really dismiss that. I exactly. mean, there's nothing else that works the way this works. So that's a huge thing. And similar response rates for PTSD and all these. You know, the stats are there to support the idea that these things are effective.
Sure. And then, you know, there's even been some work done that I've seen that's kind of shown the more abstract spiritual or interpersonal psycho-spiritual sort of side of psychedelics as well, where in Roland Griffith's trial that he did with end-of-life cancer patients, people were reporting, you know, an increase in the quality of life, you know, in an abstract conceptual way. Which is something that obviously is a bit hard to swallow for the mainstream community, because there's this whole, you know, science and spirit don't really meet, you know, in any meaningful way. But here we're seeing that they absolutely do, you know, whether these are freestanding realities or, you know, right. divine aspects of reality or whatever, people are having these spiritual experiences, and we are recording this in a scientific manner, you know, and it's having what you could call a positive effect on the subjects as well, you know, on top of that.
Yeah, that's right. That's absolutely right. I mean, this is one of the, I think, one of the most significant things about Roland's work with psilocybin on the spirituality side is that, number one, you know, I mean, he's demonstrated that the mystical experience, whatever that is, mm-hmm. And he's very careful in his phraseology, right? He doesn't say mystical experiences. He says a personally meaningful spiritual experience is kind of the way he describes it.
Very diplomatic.
But, yeah, well, because mystical experience, you know, raises flags, right?
Sure.
But two things. One is that what his work demonstrates is that you can study the mystical experience mm-hmm. scientifically. You can apply scientific protocols to it. You can quantify it. You can look at statistics and profiling and all that. So for the first time, we can actually replicably induce mystical experiences and then look at them, you know, as a phenomenon. So that's a huge thing. And these molecular, you know, psilocybin, I think of it as a molecular probe in some ways to induce these transcendent experiences and then watch what is the brain doing when you're having one of these? Or using fMRI or whatever. What are you feeling? How do you relate these things? So that's important. And then just the outcome. I mean, the people, you know, were screened afterwards, and about 30% of the sample, 30 to 35%, said it was the most personally significant, meaningful experience of their life, the single most meaningful experience of their life. And about 70% said it was among the top five.
Right.
Yeah. That's a huge thing. I mean, I don't know. You know,
that's up there with, you know, having children and that sort of thing. And
yeah, exactly.
Had children knows how incredible that experience is. And just
having children,
to know that you can, dying,
right. All these things that are, you know, things that are major life events.
Sure.
You can induce it and induce a meaningful experience. And God knows we need that. That's what people are longing for. That's why you've got, you know, a virtual, you know, migration practically of people down to South America, because people are looking out, people are reaching out for something that's spiritually and personally significant, meaningful.
Sure.
And, you know, and I mean, if we had never heard of psilocybin and we didn't have the baggage of the 60s and the sort of, you know, checkered history of psychedelics in the 20th century to, you know, if some drug company had come up with a compound like this, that had can produce the most significant experience of your life, they'd be patenting it, they'd be prescribing it, they'd be pushing it, then surely they would, right? Or, I mean, if they're not, what's the matter with them?
When you've got that, you know.
I think, you know, these kind of meaningful experiences are so hard to come by in this culture.
Sure.
You know?
Sure.
And so here's a way to have those, and I think that's a net benefit for people. They become better people.
Absolutely.
They don't have so many defenses. They're more open.
Sure.
They're kinder to other people. And this is reflected in the study, you know. I mean, they also interviewed the person's families that had this. And, you know, and they often came back and said, you know, well, Joe or George or whatever, I mean, he was a real jerk before he had this experience. Now he's like a saint.
Yeah.
Or maybe not, but, you know, a better person.
Easier to get along with,
happier. And the people around him are happier, him or her, of course, you know. So that is that's kind of, I mean that's pretty significant. That's hard to ignore. That's important.
Absolutely, and I think a really important adjunct to that that's kind of sort of goes hand in hand, especially with the natural hallucinogens, you know, psilocybin, plant-based DMT. Mescaline, these sorts of things, is that along with that kind of personal behavioral or attitudinal uplift that you get, you also tend to get a broadened appreciation for nature and the planet and for what it is that we're doing to the planet as well. I just want to mention here, because I find it really important, there's a reading that Dennis did in Melbourne last year that's on YouTube on the DMT Spirit Molecule channel, which is an excerpt from Brotherhood of the Screaming Abyss describing an ayahuasca experience in, was it Brazil?
Yeah, in Brazil, right,
yeah.
Right.
And
with photosynthesis, right.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And that's an absolutely incredible piece that to me is a very good crystallization of the effect that these plants can have on our perception of the planet and of nature and of the way that we are involved in it and what effect we're having on it. But at the same time, our arrogance in the way that we view the effect that we have on it and how that really does need to change. And I think the plants have a lot to say about that. You know, it seems to be a pretty common result that people get from having these experiences.
Yes, it is. It's a very common result, and I think it may be. I think that this goes, you know, right to the heart of the matter, in a sense, because, you know, the therapeutic applications are good and important, and but it's the spiritual experiences and it's just remarkable that that seems to be a common feature, characteristic, I guess you could say, of these psychedelic experiences, that people come away with an increased reverence for the planet and for all life on Earth and for the environment. And it's almost as though this is the message these plants are trying to get into our thick skulls, you know, is that we're screwing up nature and we're not respecting nature and we're not acknowledging that we're part of nature. We have to completely turn that around, and these are the tools that will help us to turn that around. That was the gist of my experience in, you know, with photosynthesis in Brazil with ayahuasca. And many people are coming away from their encounters with ayahuasca with a similar message. The others do it too, but ayahuasca seems to be particularly suitable or something. That seems to be the message that a lot of people connect with, and possibly it's just the mythology. It's all about the jungle, the Amazon, going down and doing that. But you can have a similar ecological revelation in your own living room, for that matter.
Absolutely.
You know? And that's really important, because here's the thing. You look at the current cultural landscape. You look at the unconsciousness of people, and the outright denial of many, many people in our society that we even have a problem. You know, and that's not going to fly. We've got to first wake up to the fact that we have a problem, and we have to change hearts and minds. That's what we have to do. We have to change people's attitude and get people to resolve to acknowledge this and then agree to do something about it. And I'm not sure what you do, but the first thing to do is you've got to wake up.
Absolutely.
And, you know, that's what these plants are desperately trying to tell us: wake up before it's too late. You know, and I waffle between great optimism and great pessimism, in this situation, because I'm optimistic. The way that ayahuasca and these other things just seem to be, you know, propagating themselves through the culture like little memes, you know, that are changing people's minds, but it's not happening fast enough.
Right.
And it's only happening to a small fraction. And, you know, the vast majority of people are still caught in their dreams and in their denial and in distraction and in just preoccupation with everything but the things that are really important. Mm-hmm. You know, those are in the background, especially these ecological environmental issues, because the time frames that they work on are different than the human time frame.
Sure.
So, you know, and we're involved, we're one, you know, the mass media focuses on what happened in the last 24-hour news cycle or, you know, at most. I mean, they don't look back much further than last week,
right?
You know, and environmental changes, we're talking time frames of 50 or 100 years.
Yeah.
The thing is, had we woken up 30 years ago, had we woken up in the early 70s to these environmental issues, we wouldn't be in the mess that we're in now.
Right.
You know, and so here we are in the mess. We're still not waking up. How much worse will it be in 50 years from now if we don't?
Yeah, you know, I absolutely
agree. That's where the worry comes from. You know, yeah. We're a very stupid species.
Well, stupid or...
And denial. We're in denial.
Yeah, or afraid. One of the two. I absolutely agree.
It's change, right? It's change. Yeah. People don't want change. People want their old, you know, people want their sort of comfortable environment. But then, you know, so they're living their lives and they're, you know, Oklahoma is a good example, which is certainly a center of places, you know, culturally. It's an epicenter of climate change and all that.
Yeah.
Of denial of climate change. Well, and then along comes an F5 tornado and completely wipes out five towns. And then, do you think those people will get the message? Well, I doubt.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I doubt it's just too.
You know, for people like you and I, it just seems ridiculous. But for people who are in that mindset, it seems to be almost less difficult to deal with a catastrophe like that than it would be to slightly alter their perception of the world and their effect on it, you know. And it seems so simple that you can have these experiences with psychedelics. And of course this also extends out to things like deep meditation and yoga and near-death experiences and all of these different things,
right?
You know these aren't specifically drug-based experiences, you know, but it's just seems so obvious that you know, people's hearts changing on a dime seems to be one of the ways that these plants have their effect. And so the fact that we don't allow this, the fact that we have these societal boxes put up and restrictions and, you know, it's shameful. It's meant to be shameful to take part in these sorts of subcultures and these sort of drug-oriented mindsets that... I can't work it out, and it is very hard to know what to do. I think it's very funny. I was watching Graham Hancock. He was on the Joe Rogan Experience yesterday.
And, thanks for the tip.
It was really good. It was really good. I recommend watching it.
Yeah,
and,
great.
It's something he always says, but it just reminded me he said it yesterday about he thinks that any national leader should have to log 10 ayahuasca sessions before they take office. And, you know, something like that while being, you know, completely far off on the distant, distant horizon, you know, I think is probably actually quite realistic, you know.
I hope so. I wish. I only wish. I don't know how... You know, it's hard to imagine the society where you could bring that about. I mean, that is like the polar opposite of our society. But that is what's called for, you know, and it would make such a difference. It would make such a difference if you could somehow, like he said, mandate 10 ayahuasca sessions as a, you know, as a qualification for office.
Yeah.
You
know? It would be
not
great.
Going to happen.
Well, no, of course not. You know, we would have no drone strikes and that kind of thing if that were the case.
right.
So, maybe speak a little bit about the academic work you've done with ayahuasca. I know in the early 90s you did a observational study with Charles Grobe of the U.D.V.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure there's others that I'm not thinking of right now. But would you like to speak about that for a few minutes, about the academic side of it and how that's been approached and what sort of information's been gotten?
Sure.
And how that could be used, you know?
Sure. Well, you know, I did my Ph.D. on ayahuasca. It was a comparative study between ayahuasca and this obscure Witoto hallucinogen called Ukuhe. They were both DMT-based, orally active, but they were different ingredients. And my thesis was basically to compare chemistry and mechanism of action and all that. So, and it was a pretty trivial concept, really, but I got the PhD.
Right.
And so then that gave me, I could publish in some peer-reviewed journals, and that led to the UDV. And I published my work in 1984, and didn't really know anything about the UDV until they invited me to, along with a bunch of other luminaries or researchers, Jace Calloway and Charlie Grobe, and actually, was Charlie there? I don't know if Charlie was even there, but anyway, they invited us to this conference in Sao Paulo, which was a medical conference, and the agenda was that they wanted to have a biomedical study of ayahuasca done so that their drug authorities would not ban religious use. That was the whole rationale for them doing this. And they figured if we can invite some foreign scientists and get them involved and get a study done, this will be a huge, you know, political, very astute political move, which it turned out to be. And so they invited us. They weren't really explicit about that was their agenda, but it all came out in the conversations, you know, between the PowerPoints and all that. And so we said, great, because actually this is what we wanted to do too. That was our agenda. And so we went back and we got some money through a couple of nonprofit venues, one of which was Botanical Dimensions. And which was a nonprofit my brother and his wife were involved in at the time. And we got money and we went back and carried out that study. And we had basically the study was not that creative, or we just wanted to answer some basic questions, right? We wanted to analyze the medicines and determine what was in there. We wanted to do pharmacokinetics. We wanted to look at the course of action of the drug in these volunteers, look at the usual parameters, you know, blood pressure, heart rate, pupil dilation. And we also carried out these structured psychiatric interviews of all the subjects. And that was where it was really got most interesting, because they all said, you know, in the context of these interviews, their life story were that they were in a dysfunctional place before they joined the UDV. They were alcoholics, they were drug addicts, they were involved in crime, domestic violence, and just basically dysfunctional lives. And in an existential crisis before they joined the church, usually they went to the ceremonies at the urging of a friend who was a member. They had, as a rule, they had these rather incredible experiences that were also quite terrifying in a sense. They often had a vision of where they were headed, and, you know, over the cliff, sometimes literally that was the cliff. That one fellow related a vision of being in a canoe on a river, and he could sense that he was about to go over a waterfall. And, you know, suddenly in the canoe ahead of him, the Mestre Gabriel appeared in all his glory and said, "It'll be okay, my son." All that. So he came away with the feeling that as long as he stayed in the UDV and as long as he took the tea, he was going to get his life back on track. And that was pretty much the story they all told. Right. So that was remarkable. They stopped using drugs. If that was their problem, they stopped drinking. They became, you know,
more pretty much
functional people. And then we had this, we didn't really know what we were doing, but we had a question we were asking, which is there a biochemical marker in ayahuasca drinkers that differentiates them from non-drinkers. Right. We had no idea what that might be. You know, we were just kind of throwing that question out there. Is their brains different? Is there something obvious different? We were using receptor binding technologies and platelet samples to look at receptor profiles.
Right.
And we found this unexpected result, which was the serotonin transporter, which is the thing that the antidepressants work on, the pump in the presynaptic membrane that reuptakes the transmitter. We found that the serotonin transporters, at least in the platelets, were elevated, significantly elevated compared to controls. And we didn't know what that meant. We thought, gee, that's interesting. Maybe that's related to this. And so then we looked in the literature, and it turns out there is actually a fairly extensive literature related to deficits in these transporters that are linked to alcoholism and violent alcoholism, homicide, suicide, certain kinds of depression, other kinds of, you know, obesity and bulimia, eating disorders. A whole bunch of syndromes, dysfunctional syndromes, are related to deficits in these transporters, abnormally low levels. So we thought, wow, this is incredible. Ayahuasca apparently reduces these deficits, you know, and it's a leap, but it makes sense. What, sure. You know, and here's where we need to follow it up with more work, because you know, and where it's going to be difficult, but because what I would like to see happen is actually there's various ways that you could approach it. But if you could do a prospective study, you know, if you could get some people that are just that are in this state that haven't really yet joined the UDV maybe and are thinking about it, you could get measured those profiles and then let them join, let them get into it for a while, compare them, do a behavioral profile over time and say, well, you know, a year ago you were in jail and, you know, shooting heroin, and now you're practically like a Mormon or something, you know? So it's simple study, hard to get it done, but a simple study, you know? And that's actually one of the areas that I'm kind of excited about now, because, you know, for a long time we've struggled with the idea we're getting all this clinical work done with psilocybin, clinical work done with MDMA. But ayahuasca is a tough one because it's a plant. The FDA has an inbuilt prejudice against plants. And there's no authorized source of ayahuasca that you could work into an FDA protocol, right? So for a long time, we struggled against that. So anyway, what we've been thinking about, or what I've been thinking about lately, I mean, I went through a stage where I thought, well, why even bother to do it, you know? But then lately I've been thinking, well, why do we just not play this FDA game? Let's just step out of that whole framework and go do this work in Peru.
Right.
And some opportunities have come up, and it looks like that's possibly what we're going to do. We're actually talking to a retreat center down in Urubamba, Peru, that they have ayahuasca retreats, but they would be open to doing some clinical studies there.
Yeah.
And we could do it there. So maybe that's where that will happen. The important thing is that you do rigorous, good science, and it doesn't matter what it's done if it's good science.
Yeah. I think it probably makes sense to do it in Peru as well, because you then have the very specific set and setting that comes with ayahuasca. You know, it's of the rainforest, and it seems to have its biggest effect when you're there immersed in the culture that has used it for thousands of years, you know.
Yeah.
Or at least,
yeah, and we can also, exactly, we can, you know, it is in the right context. The Peruvian government will support this thing, at least you know, completely in terms of being allowed to do it. No issue. I think that, you know, it's also a way to kind of move this idea along of the merger of traditional shamanic practice and psychiatric practice, you know, and just get a so carefully screened group of people, of patients with either PTSD or alcoholism. That's probably the two primary therapeutic targets. Get them well prepared and diagnosed according to Western criteria before they go down. Take them down there. Give them a series of treatments. Track it all through, and I think you could do some very good work that would prove that ayahuasca works. And we know it works, you know, but we need the quantitative data, that's all.
Sure. Yeah. And that would also open up a number of other areas. I mean, I was just thinking as you were talking about some of the, you know, slightly wild but still incredibly interesting hypotheses that Jeremy Nabi puts forward about the scientific properties of the experience as opposed to physiological scientific properties. And, you know, perhaps if we were able to get some of the physical science done and the neuroscience and the biochemistry and that sort of thing understood as significant and scientifically viable, then maybe you'd actually have an opportunity to expand on the type of things that Roland Griffiths was doing and that Charles Grob has done and get some of those experiences quantified. And maybe we'll finally have the answer of, you know, was it Terence that always asked the mushroom, you know, tell me something I don't already know. And, you know, so you might be able to get to a point where you could show whether that is actually possible or not.
That would be, yeah, exactly. That would be also very interesting to be able to do that. Well, that's the idea. If you could just have a place in Peru that is more or less a platform for good ayahuasca research, where the brew is consistent and the practitioner is good and has integrity and is not out, you know, to molest people or whatever, and just carry out these experiments. You know, I mean, Jeremy Narby's work with problem solving and getting molecular biologists and people like that down to take ayahuasca and talk with the shamans. I mean, at the MAPS conference, he gave some very interesting talks, or his presentation was very interesting about some of these sessions, and you know, he gave one very interesting talk, I'm trying to think, where there was a molecular biologist there, and there was the shaman there, and there was also a French artist who was able to paint these images that they were talking about, and they were talking cell biology here, you know. I mean, it's very interesting in that way. And Jim Fadiman is another one who's led a lot of investigations about psychedelics and creativity and applications to problem solving and all that. So, you know, that's very encouraging. And I think that that is ultimately, you know, I mean, that sort of goes beyond the merely therapeutic aspect.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, of course, I'm an eternal optimist, so I sort of just dive into the topics that, you know, are a little far out on the horizon currently, but, you know.
Well, but they, you know, until people study them, they're far out on the horizon, but there's no reason why they can't be addressed and explored.
Yeah.
And they are, and that's happening, and that's ultimately good, you know.
Sure.
I mean, I don't know. I sometimes think, I mean, I think that therapy is great, and I think that religious and spiritual use is good, but I think that these are just facets of the psychedelics and not the whole story, and maybe not the most interesting story, you know.
Well, of course, I mean, some people I know who I would consider at least semi-spiritual people have taken psychedelics in, you know, intellectually quiet setting and in a way that's supportive of that kind of experience, and they've not really felt anything from it. They've sort of said, you know, that was a great experience and I had a good time, but it's not necessarily there for everybody. So I think you're absolutely right. I think that there's a slight, I was actually going to ask about this in a minute, that, you know, there's a balance between that scientific approach and the spiritual approach where, you know, it's very hard to put more pressure on one than the other. It's very hard to approach it with one mind and not the other mind, because then you end up with these really, these really kind of unbalanced views of things, where you'll have people that they're only interested in what it's actually doing in your brain, and then, you know, you don't really get the message. But then if you're only interested in what it does to your mind, then you're missing.
Yeah, you really have to. You really have to integrate these. You have to integrate these approaches. I mean, if it didn't do the interesting things it does experientially, who cares what it does in the brain?
Right.
You know. I mean, it's only because of that that we're interested in what it does in the brain. But then you've got a certain, you know, faction who. And this is part of the limitations of science. They like to look at it and they like to reduce it to what's happening in the brain.
Right. Yeah.
And it's no more than that. You're disturbing neurochemistry in a certain way, and this is what happens. And I don't think that's a valid model either. You can't reduce it. What the power of these tools is to bring these things together. Even with all the tools that we have of neuroscience, the neuroimaging and all that, it's great. You can say, okay, give psilocybin to somebody and, you know, the anterior cingulate gyrus lights up and the limbic system lights up and there's, you know, reduced activity in the occipital lobe and, you know, increased in the frontal lobe and all that. But, you know, I mean, these are good observations, but they're almost like incantations.
Right.
They still don't tell you what the hell is going on.
Yeah.
Right? How does, and this isn't about psychedelics, this is about experience itself. How does neural activity of any kind generate reality?
Mm.
Or does it generate reality? What's the relation, you know? And
right. I mean, I was going to ask, you know, what is your view on that? You know, the idea that this is with reference in my mind to I can't remember who did it, but there was a study with psilocybin and brain patterning with people on psilocybin, and that a lot of cognitive function is actually reduced under the effect of psilocybin, and so the mind is effectively quietened, if you want to call it that. And I was just wondering what your view is.
Or these different parts of the brain are somehow more isolated from each other.
Right, right.
So the feedback loops that kind of always knit them together to create this hallucination of reality, if you will, that's disrupted, and they all work more independently. And kind of that's you're thinking of Nutt's work, right, David Nutt's?
Yes, that's
right. Yeah.
And I was just wondering how you view, I mean, obviously you have a much deeper understanding of the chemistry and the neurology of it than I would, or probably most people that are going to hear this interview, but how do you feel about the idea of consciousness either being generated in the brain or something that is tapped into somehow as, you know, as a physical being, we have some way of harnessing the consciousness that's already there. How is your experience with, obviously, the abstract spiritual side of psychedelics and just your life in general, and then also as a scientist and as someone who has looked deeply at neurochemistry and that sort of thing, what take have you formed on it over the whole thing?
Well, well, as a scientist, you know, the temptation is always strong to retreat into the last bastion of scoundrels and say, I don't know.
Right.
I mean, we need more data. We certainly need more data. I think this is where the limitations of science become very apparent. We just don't know enough right now, I think, to say there is that consciousness is not confined to the brain. It's something that the brain is like a detector, like a television receiver, as Graham Hancock likes to talk about, and mind or consciousness is more like a quality of the continuum built into the structure of reality. That's not the scientific reductionist paradigm, but more and more I'm leaning toward that. I think anybody who has psychedelic experiences has to kind of lean toward that as a possible explanation, because is the brain even capable of coming up with this shit, you know?
Yeah,
well. Where does all this come from? So that goes back to the question of, tell me something I can't possibly know. Yeah. I mean, you know, I think this goes back to the real, you know, the real significance of psychedelics in the next 50 years or so will not be so much the therapeutic applications as it has the potential to completely, turn our understanding of reality on its ear.
Sure.
You know, if we can begin to actually gather evidence that there is, that mind is something that exists out there, or is not confined to the brain, that the brain is more of a detector, and that these shamanic dimensions that we encounter are really real places. I mean, the terminology is so tricky, right? I'm saying places, I'm saying out there, external, internal. These are, none of these phrases are very, you know, they don't really get it, because they all spring from this Cartesian dualistic perspective that there's an inner and an outer, and, you know, and we know that's not true. But we experience it that way, and at least we Westerners do. We have to take psychedelics to experience it a different way. Indigenous people may experience it much more that way all the time. They're burdened with our 400 or 500 years of Cartesian dualism, which I think has really conditioned the way we think about things.
Well, I think that's one of the really big problems, and where direct, true science is going to be an effective tool for expanding the scope in terms of the cultural acceptance of psychedelics, is that the language is so hard to use. You know, for somebody who's not a psychedelic person, a lot of what we've been saying is still going to sound pretty weird. You know,
it's going to sound very weird. I mean, it sounds like mystics. It sounds like, you know, Eastern practitioners of yoga and things like that. The Eastern religious traditions are quite comfortable with this.
Yeah.
You know, they've always said that, but those are not considered scientific. And, you know, and we have to, you know, I mean, science is, you know, it's a problematic thing because, you know, it is a powerful methodology, a powerful tool for asking questions of reality and getting answers back that are more or less verifiable or testable. And so that's not a trivial thing. But then there's a temptation to arrogance too, to say, well, you know, if it doesn't fit within our paradigms, it's not real.
Sure.
Or it's not worth talking about, and so it leaves out a lot. I mean, the scientific view of the world is a very incomplete worldview.
Sure.
It only gets as far as it goes by the, you know, deliberate decision to exclude phenomena.
Yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
That we know happens. And that's how it works. You have to exclude as many variables as possible. So you can just focus on that one variable, but that's not how reality is structured.
No, you know, with psychedelics, I think one of the really telling points on, excuse me, the science of it and how that's going to move forward is that we have MAPS, which is multidisciplinary, you know, and science by and large is something that is very much compartmentalized into different disciplines. You know, obviously Graham's run into this a lot in his work on history, where different disciplines stepping on each other's toes result in some pretty outrageous backlashes toward each other. And I think approaching this with a multidisciplinary view, you know, where you have, you know, 2,000 people together in a weekend, and, you know, there's neuroscientists, there's anthropologists, there's biochemists, there's psychiatrists, there's, you know, absolutely everything under the sun putting their two cents into this thing. You know, I think that's probably going to be one of the big things in favor for psychedelic studies to be taken a bit more seriously, is that you end up having a much more harmonious overall view of the thing.
Well, yeah, exactly. I agree. It does tie these different disciplines together, and it encourages them to, yeah, lower your defenses. This is not territory you're defending, or, you know, we need to bring it all together. It's inherently an interdisciplinary problem. You know, and there can be a lot of cross-fertilization, because fundamentally it has to do with our understanding of, you know, our place,
yeah,
in nature, who we are, what reality is. I mean, the big questions.
Yeah.
Psychedelics ties all this stuff together and forces us to... excuse me. Look at... or speculate about it anyway. And in that sense, you know, it's a paradigm changer. It's a catalyst in the evolution of our understanding. So I think that's really maybe its most important, you know, its most important effect going forward.
Yeah.
You know, and clearly, and you know, I mean, some sciences are farther along than others. I mean, paradoxically, if you talk to physicists, you know, the stuff they talk about is just, it's crazy talk. They sound like mystics.
Right, right.
And people that are taking psychedelic, I mean, we can't even make sense, but they're the ones that are saying fundamentally, you know, this is the nature of reality. And the thing is, you know, any model of a reality or consciousness or whatever that dismisses these states of mind, these altered states, it's an incomplete model,
yeah,
and it will ever be incomplete. We have to address this, acknowledge it, and integrate it some way. So it's just, you know, it's hard to know, you know, 50 years from now, what will the sort of reigning scientific paradigm look like? Will there be progress or not?
Yeah, I had it was ontologically just a little bit funny. I had an experience the other day. I was just on the net looking at some different things, and I was on YouTube, and I'd been watching, there's a MAPS event, and there was a psychiatrist, I believe, sitting with a Buddhist monk, and they're talking about Buddhism and psychedelics and how there's a lot of overlap between the two, and how sort of the conclusions tend to be pretty, pretty parallel and pretty, they work together quite well. They mesh together quite well. And then the next video that I ended up seeing was Graham Hancock questioning Richard Dawkins about trying mushrooms. And I thought this was really interesting. You know, you've got, on the one hand, you have this kind of really extreme Eastern, you know, for Western culture, this quite extreme Eastern religion in Buddhism, and then you have the exact opposite side of it, where you have this very extreme scientific, almost derisive, you know, man in Richard Dawkins. And they were both very open to the fact that psychedelics was something that could potentially tie the two together.
Well, that's good.
Yeah.
Maybe there's hope for Richard Dawkins after all. Yeah. I mean, so did he say he would take psychedelics?
He did. It was very typically Richard Dawkins, where he said he would be interested in trying it, and he would be open to taking, for instance, a decent dose of mushrooms and seeing what kind of experience it gave him, but he was also very quick to point out that he did not think it would give him a spiritual experience and that he did not think it would be something particularly significant. But
as I've often said in some of my raps, the great thing about psychedelics is you don't have to have faith.
Exactly. Right? Yeah, I was just about to make reference to manifesting the mind where you...
Yeah. It doesn't require faith, whether you're religious or anti-religious.
Well, you'll just have the experience anyway.
Sit down, shut up, and munch the mushrooms.
and that's where the science kind of comes in, because you can then say, you know, this is biochemically, it is doing these things. You know, it's not something that you can escape by the power of suggestion, you know.
Right.
Something you can probably ignore and deny and try to pretend didn't happen, but you would have always had that experience.
You can't deny it. You can't say it doesn't do something, but you can devalue it. You can say, that is a disturbance. You know, it's disturbing my neurochemistry, and that's why I'm having those things, right? Those experiences. Granted, that's true. That begs the question of, how does your normal neurochemistry generate your normal reality? Because that's also, you know, we're high on drugs all the time, right? I mean, we're made of drugs.
Yeah.
That's the thing. We're made of drugs. And so ordinary reality is just another kind of neurochemical brain state in some way.
And, you know, very conveniently, a lot of the psychedelics are very, very close to brain chemistry as well. So,
yeah,
there is some validity in the fact that, you know, some foods are probably more chemically disturbing than psychedelics are, you know, to brain chemistry. So I think that that's an interesting thing to point out to somebody who is a little bit skeptical, is to say, you know, I mean, first off, DMT is present in the body in various ways, in the spinal fluid and that sort of thing. And then psilocybin, psilocin,
they're very, very close.
5-MeO, all of these things are all very, very close.
These neurotransmitters, absolutely. Right.
LSD even, which is, you know, of course it's synthetic, but it's also very, very close to serotonin, isn't it, chemically speaking?
It's very close to serotonin, that's right. And again, that, in a way, that is another, you know, if you will, a signature, I think, or a message of nature that is pointing out that, you know, that our arbitrary distinctions between the external and the internal are really arbitrary.
Right.
You know, these neurotransmitter-like compounds in nature are messenger molecules that probably mediate relationships between organisms.
Right.
And they become adapted to an internal signal transduction function in our nervous systems, but they're still messenger molecules,
right.
You know, with similar effects. So, you know, again, a message that we're not really separate from nature. We're all part of the same biochemical soup, you know, and... and that's another thing that people have a hard time with, you know, admitting that we're just, you know, I mean, what, we have somewhat fewer genes than a turnip or something like that?
Yeah.
That's kind of humbling.
Well, yeah, exactly. You know, when you really look at things like that, you kind of realize that our view of ourselves is way off. And it doesn't work. You know, I think that's the important thing, is really, you can forget all of the, you don't necessarily have to defend yourself on this point, because just look at the world, it doesn't work. You know, we're destroying the lungs of the planet, we're, you know, letting millions and millions of people live in poverty all over the place, we're, you know, consumer culture, I mean, you've gone so far as to call it the death culture, you know, and I have to agree with you, you know, it's a very restrictive, it's just... incredibly restrictive in pretty much all ways, and as Graham said, this, we're cut off from spirit, you know, and there's no inherent purpose in people's lives anymore, so everybody gets sort of tricked or duped into doing things for other people that do have some clue about what's going on.
People are just preoccupied with their, you know, they're very restricted, their entertainment and their machines and their And you know, and I mean, I like those things as much as anybody. And I don't think any. I mean, you could take a lot of psychedelics and still be you know, vulnerable to that. But. And I don't know what you do. I mean, it's more a change in perception than it is anything else. I mean, I don't have to, you know, necessarily turn my iPhone, you know, into the recyclers or whatever. But it's just a question of how you relate to the environment that we find ourselves in, sure. You know, sort of the cognitive environment that we inhabit. And, you know, I mean, Terence used to say, and I think it's clear, you know, culture is not your friend. Yeah. You know, he had a very good talk by that title, and I think he's absolutely right. There are all these forces that are encouraging people not to wake up, you know. Yeah. Don't look over here. There's nothing going on over there. Move on now. There's nothing to see. Yeah. Go back to your whatever it was you were doing before. In other words, don't wake up. Mm. You know, why that should be, I mean, I think that everyone should have something invested in the idea of survival. Mm. But it's surprising that there are so many forces in the world that... seem to be, you know, it's like, don't think about that. Yeah. Don't think long term. Yeah. Just don't think about it, you know, because it, I don't know, it'll hurt the economy or something.
Something, yeah.
It and, hurt yes. the economy when we're all dead and the planet is uninhabitable.
Yeah, of course. And, you know, this ties straight back into the ideology surrounding the drug war and why, you know, certain drugs are okay and certain drugs aren't and all that sort of thing. And I make reference to Bill Hicks here, who just, you know, was very, very quick on these matters. And he was sort of saying, you know, you have caffeine during the week, which gets you up to go to work and do something you don't like doing, and then alcohol for the weekend that keeps you too stupid to know, you know, to realize the prison that you're in. And I think that's, right. You know, in a lot of Western culture, I think that's probably actually quite accurate. I mean, obviously, it was a joke, but it's quite accurate.
And yeah, I think it's quite accurate, and I think, yeah, and now even, you know, I mean, we have other things besides the two, you know, the alcohol and the caffeine, which are kind of the basic, you know, pharmacological tools of social engineering, if you will, you know, but now we've got the whole biomedical psychopharmaceutical right. industrial complex. Every aspect of personality from earliest childhood is pharmacologically modulated. And, you know, if you show the slightest deviation from accepted behavior, if you're sad, if you're a little bit rambunctious or whatever, we have pills for all that. That'll, you know, we can give you these pills. You've got, you know, ADHD or, you know, depression or social anxiety disorder. And it's not that these things aren't real. I mean, I mean, for some people, they are. But I think there's a tendency to overdiagnose them.
Absolutely.
And too quickly go to the medicine cabinet and say, well, you know, we have these pills that will correct the situation, and they don't. They just, you know, those medicines are often given, they're not given to benefit the patients, they're given to benefit everybody else, you know, the therapists, the people that have to deal with them, make them docile, good producer consumers, you know? I mean, isn't that what it's all about? That's what we're here for.
Yeah, I think that's probably quite true, you know. Psychedelics especially, you know, obviously you've got your MDMA and ketamine and a number of others like that, but the true plant psychedelics, at least, you know, this was sort of his main area that he put his thrust in when he spoke about psychedelics, I think anyway, was that they decondition those cultural parameters and they get you outside of that box and they get you thinking about, you know, how badly the walls were pulled over your eyes and what you could do to get outside of that. And, you know, that's, you know, that encompasses the culture is not your friend thing, but, you know, that breaks down to obviously avoiding the sort of psychiatric pharmacology of the world, the media, you know, the absolute bullshit that gets peddled in the media constantly.
And all the pressure that comes from peers and doctors and teachers. I mean, it's very hard to resist if some physician, you know, that you're entrained to look up to and trust to say, I really think you need to go on this Seroquel or antidepressant or whatever for possibly the rest of your life. I mean, you know, most people are going to be very influenced by that. And we're conditioned to look up to those kinds of authority and obey them, you know. And then you get psychedelic people who, you know, tend to be a little more rebellious and resist that. And you know, it's funny ideas. I mean, that the psychedelics are dangerous because they give you funny ideas. Right. They give you unconventional ideas. They are dangerous, all right, but they're not dangerous to the people who have them.
You know? Wasn't it
Timothy Leary who said that, you know, LSD is very dangerous. It can cause psychotic reactions in people who don't take it.
Yeah, exactly. And that seems to be the case. I mean, you know, how many more examples are there of, for instance, parents having panic attacks about their children taking psychedelics than there actually have been of children sort of late teenage on. Yeah, taking psychedelics and having bad experiences. I'm sure it would be very interesting to see how that would actually be swayed. Absolutely. And I think the other thing that psychedelics probably do for the people that do take it, you know, an effect that it actually has for people who do take it, is that it brings forward the, again, this is a Terence thing, you know, this, it brings forward the primacy of immediate experience. So you're in a position where you're confident to say, I've had this experience and it's changed my view on life, and I feel like I'm, you know, it's a slippery slope saying these things, but I feel like a better person and a more compassionate, loving, helpful human being. And so, fuck what everybody else says. You know, I've had this experience and it's made me feel how I feel, and so I'm going to go ahead and get on with my life and do what it is I want to do. Where people who, as far as I can tell, who don't have that experience are constantly seeking validation from their parents or their teachers or doctors or politicians or whoever it is, in the control group that they ascribe to in their own lives. They're constantly looking for that, and psychedelics seems to empower people to have their own experiences and say, no, I'm sorry, this is what's going on, and this is the experience that I've had, and I'm not going to wait for a lot of people to tell me that I'm correct, you know, which I think is something...
Yeah. I think that's a very profound insight, right? Psychedelics give you the permission, the power, in a sense, to not look outside yourself for validation, but to find that within yourself. Once you've found that center, that's the lesson. And you become a much more balanced person. You become even a wise person. You know, I mean, that's a word that's dangerous to throw around, but I think in some ways that's what it does. You know, the wisdom that psychedelics teaches you is that, the truth is to be found within ourselves, and don't get too damn arrogant, you know?
I mean, absolutely.
Never lose sight of the fact that you don't know much.
Yeah. And there's a nice interface there, I think, in the U.D.V. and the Santo Daime Church, because they are Christian syncretic churches.
Right.
But what the medicine has sort of done for them is, as far as I can tell, obviously I'm not a member or anything, but as far as I can tell, it's allowed them to look at the words of Christ and look at the scriptures and actually read what's there rather than what's been taught over history, you know, because when you look at the words of Christ, there's nothing there but love and compassion and as a general statement to look inward and to take responsibility for yourself and to be able to become a better person because it's the right thing to do, not because you've been told to do it. And it seems that something that's happened there is that you can take something like Christianity and take a lot of the toxic aspects out of it and have it something that instead of leading towards patterns of abuse, where it has done in the Catholic Church, obviously, in the UDV it seems to have done exactly the opposite and aimed directly away from patterns of abuse. And I think that's quite significant, because you don't have to be dismissive of either side of the coin.
You know? Right. You can return to the original message of these of Christianity, which is right. It's based on love and compassion, and not so much judgmental. It tends to be too judgmental. That's the problem, and condemnatory, if that's a term, of other people. And it really in the way that Jesus taught it, it's a much more personal thing. Yeah. It's almost like it's very resonant with Eastern religions too, in that way.
Well, one of the
goal is personal development and evolution and all that.
And one of the sort of theories about Christ floating around is that he did, in his missing years, go to the East, and he learnt some Eastern spiritual practices, whether it was Buddhism or Hinduism, whichever. But then he brought them back, and that's sort of what we get in the New Testament, which I think is pretty interesting, because it does seem to have so many parallels with
that Eastern mysticism.
And bringing it all back, that all then has a lot of parallel with psychedelic philosophy. Psychedelic philosophy is all about, you actually get to experience that unconditional life. You actually get to be in the presence of what all these other religions are calling gods, and the cosmic power and all that sort of thing. You actually get to experience that, and you get to know, as far as you're concerned, at least. Again, as something Terence said, you can never know if somebody else has seen what you've seen with psychedelics. You can only know that you've seen the center and the heart of the stone, but you could do it. And it's replicable, and it's...
Well, you can compare notes, at least.
Yeah.
And we can compare notes to the point where we can say people are, if not seeing the same things, they're seeing some very similar things. Sure. And and again, that's true of ordinary reality as well. We don't know... reality, I really believe it is a hallucination that we fabricate and live inside and inhabit. Other people are inhabiting their own hallucination, which is similar to ours, but not the same, but it overlaps enough that we can talk to each other.
Get on.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and... I think it's very interesting when you do have these experiences and you do compare notes and you do sort of, look at these things phenomenologically. Benny Shannon at the Hebrew University in Israel has a great, great book called The Antipodes of the Mind, which is, incredible study of the phenomenology of ayahuasca. He took it in excess of 400 times, something like that, before the book was published. And it's incredible looking at those things. And the next thing I actually was going to talk about for a little bit, which this segues really well into, is psychedelic art, and how you look at psychedelic art. And of course, you have people who are incredibly specific in their stylizations. For instance, Alex Gray. Nobody's art resembles Alex Gray's. That's incredibly specific and incredibly personal and very, very stylized. But with a lot of visionary art, it is very similar. A lot of these artists are seeing very, very similar things, especially with ayahuasca art. You have something like Pablo Amoringo's art. And then there's a number of other artists like Martina Hoffman and Robert Mosser and people like that they're not strictly ayahuasca visionaries, but when they do display...
Do you think there's a conscious attempt to emulate somebody like Amoringo? Is that possibly the reason
they... I think it's possible. That's what I was going to talk about was, there's two sides to that coin, because I think it's very possible. I think he's a He's an artist that you would probably want to emulate. It's absolutely beautiful art, and it's very real and very natural and probably quite accurate from what I can tell as well. And would it be that, or would it be that these experiences are actually so similar that people are...
Well, yeah, that's a question. I mean, that's one of the questions. Are they really, are these experiences similar because they're looking at similar territory? And it really is, again, somewhere, if it's not here, which doesn't mean it's out there, but it's, you get hung up in these inaccurate metaphors about localization. Yeah. But in other words, is it a dimension? Just call it a dimension for now that everyone kind of, it's like taking a walk in the forest. If you each different person takes a walk in the forest, comes back and paints a painting, they're going to paint different things, but it will be clear that it all came from the same forest.
Right.
It's a crude metaphor, but
sure.
And I think that may be what's happening. But science will say, where do you get? How do you absolutely demonstrate this? Mm. And what would absolutely demonstrate it?
Right. I think Graham did some really, really, really good research in supernatural with the phenomenology of art, all the way from cave paintings, the oldest cave paintings, and tracking different devices that are ubiquitous to these certain experiences. And he convinced me to some degree, definitely, that I think there are some aspects of this type of art, like the geometric nature and things like therianthropes and just certain other...
This theme of the wounded shaman.
The sort of ordeal.
It shows up.
The ordeal journey thing. That seemed to be pretty ubiquitous. I mean, through a lot of different art. And then, obviously, modern art is a bit different because we don't have that, that grounding in this shamanic way of going about things, and there aren't really shamanic lineages, and in the West we just don't have it. We don't have shamans in the West. We have people who can drink a lot,
and that's about
it. And so obviously there's going to be a difference there. Modern art is a lot more polished, a lot more kind of skillful because we've had the time to bring this forward. But then is the question that the modern visionary art is a refinement of the same ubiquitous universal models that came out of these more ancient shamanic art.
I see what you're saying. Yeah, modern art, I mean, art as art is more of a, it's about technique, it's about being art. It doesn't necessarily have to depict anything, and a lot of it doesn't particularly, but I think what you're saying, or what I'm getting from what you're saying, is that this visionary art really is an attempt to depict something. And it takes its root from the cave paintings were the first visionary art, and it's just evolved since then. But it's not an attempt to create art for art's sake. It's an attempt to utilize art to actually visualize something that's understood to be real on some level.
Sure, and to be able to pull that back out and to get something from it as well. Obviously in Jeremy Nabi's book, he was very, very clear that a lot of the art, from his point of view, has been depicting these different, bacterial or cell division in some... Mm-hmm. Examples, there's specifically cells dividing in anaphase in some of this indigenous art, and but I find that really interesting because I think it gives you a cultural, media based, media is a loose word, but a culturally expressive basis for introducing this to people who maybe aren't interested in spirit or science, people who aren't scientific minded but also aren't interested in spirit. You then still have a very interesting set of data there, mm-hmm. kind of hard to use that word when it comes to art, but you have this set of data there that you can point out these various ideas that are worth studying. And eventually when you get back and you realize that, you know, the first human art was essentially visionary art.
Yeah,
you have to start taking this bit seriously, culturally, you know, and ask why these things aren't part of our culture anymore. You know, why are we in a culture that's so severed from this sort of expressive and honest, you know, these very honest aspects of experience, where experience is brought to the front, you know, rather than sort of a non-questioning of other people's experience.
Yeah, I don't know.
It's very odd.
Let me ask you, let me turn it around for a second and say, what do you, in this context, what do you make of Aboriginal art or Maori traditional art?
I've had a very strange sort of history with that, because for years and years I was not particularly interested. It's a very, very young culture, you know, as far as we're told, it's only about 800 years old, something like that.
Maori culture.
Yeah. And that there is no shamans in Maori culture, as far as I know. There's no substances that are used. There isn't even any sort of, with the Australian Aboriginals, you have Dreamtime, which is, you know, a essentially a psychedelic experience, but it's just not induced by drugs. But with the Maori culture, there's nothing like that. However, I have heard from a number of sources that what the public understands about Maori culture may not be, you know, all that's there, in the same way that the, you know, the conquistadors in South America and Central America very much skewed the history of these peoples and skewed the motives. And one of the results of that was to very much downplay the use of plants and the spiritual experience that they were having. I've heard from Maori what are called elders, that there is actually some lineage of that there, and that's just something that's not sort of allowable in the academic studies of these things, because what we're told is, no, 800 years old, they came from Southeast Asia, and this is what's happened, and, you know, there's not really any questioning that. But, you know, there's been numbers of artifacts and sites and things that have put that into question.
But there's some that question it, and some evidence that it might be much older.
Yeah. I've seen some, what I consider fairly convincing evidence that there's at least, there's sites and artifacts that have not been answered, and they very, very well may be older. So my experience of the art is that it's probably a result of the natural world here. I mean, it's quite obvious that the plant life here, and the fact that we're surrounded by ocean and mountains and various weird and wonderful animals and that sort of thing, is a pretty direct link to the type of art that we get.
Right.
The figurative,
although
art.
I must say, some of the Maori sculptures and so on, which I'm certainly no expert in, but they seem very psychedelic. And these sprites or these creatures that they depict, I mean, they look like they're right out of DMT land.
Well, exactly. That's the thing. I've been told by Maoris that this may very well be the case, that, you know, the sprites and elves, and then there's the Japanese Haruki and all of these different things, which essentially amount to DMT elves. Yeah, you know, at the end of the day, they're all based on the same thing. I've been told that could be what it is. So,
really?
You know, I've held off any judgment on it, because what we're given in the mainstream is that there is no culture of that, but no history of that, sorry. But I've been told that there actually is, so I've kind of held off on.
And what do you think about the Aborigines, which we know they're one of the more ancient cultures?
Yeah.
Did they know about DMT? Were they using acacias?
I think it's absolutely possible. I think, you know, we saw the guys from Prism talk last year in Melbourne, and one of them made the point that there is, you know, there's this particular acacia that's got the highest concentration of DMT in its leaves than any leafed plant in the world. And I think it would be very hard for a culture to be on its own on a continent for 30, 40,000 years and not utilize something like that and not, you know, find the same uses that all other cultures do.
Although, you know, unless, I mean, there's two, you know, unless, I mean, a culture like that could consume acacias as a solid green. I mean, this goes on Africa. There's an acacia nilotica, which the Maasai people use. They eat it. It's an herb. They don't know it's hallucinogenic. It's loaded with DMT. But the day that they mix another herb with it, which happens to contain an MAO inhibitor, and then, you know, all bets are off. And it seems like the Aborigines... You know, what I have heard suggested is that they, you know, the concentrations of DMT in these acacias is so high that you could actually, in a like an enclosed space, put them on coals, you know, put them over fire and let the smoke come off of them. Yeah. And you would actually get to an active dose that way.
Right.
Well, I think some of you guys out there over there should be trying this.
Right. Yeah. Well, unfortunately, in New Zealand, we don't have the we don't have the acacias in New Zealand. Unfortunately, only in Australia. No. We only have there is some DMT containing acacias here, but they're an incredibly small amount, from what I understand. Mm. We have no plants here that are high in DMT, unfortunately. And nobody that has the audacity to make any either. So it's very hard to come by here. But luckily we have a lot of mushrooms and things. I was just going to ask, do the Maasai people...
You have quite a number of mushroom species there, right?
Yeah. There's about 6 or 7 different species. And that's not including... There's Semilantiata grows in the South Island where it's cold all year round. And they only grow in the South Island, so I've never seen them where I live, which is in the North Island of the country. But there's a good number. I was going to ask, do the Maasai people have a shamanic history, or do they have indigenous art that appears to be psychedelic?
Not that I know of.
Right.
I don't know.
You know, that was the one thing I was going to just put in favor of the Aboriginals being, you know, potentially psychedelic, is that they do have this... very rich history.
Oh yeah,
of
their art is very
psychedelic. Yeah, it appears to be. You know, and whether that was drug induced or ordeal induced, you know, it does seem to be there. And you know, their mythology seemed to be very similar to a lot of the other shamanic mythologies of various kinds around the world. You know.
Yeah.
Yeah, New Zealand's very interesting. We have a population that are very open and very able to take their own experiences and say. For instance, we have a very high report rate for UFO sightings because people here are not very worried about being judged or anything. They just say, "Well, I saw this thing, so you know, if you think I'm crazy or anything like that." But we don't have any shamanic lineages. We don't have any indigenous altered state, you know, mythology. We don't.
Right.
And it's really interesting because our people are really open to it. You know, currently people are really open to it. And you know, most of the people I know are psychedelic people, and I haven't even tried. You know, I haven't really looked for psychedelic people, and most of the people I know have. Either had the experiences while they were growing up or turned to it later on, just looking at indigenous cultures and conservation and all of that sort
but
of thing.
But what about, isn't there a much larger demographic that's completely outside of that in New Zealand? Or you don't?
I think it's very hard to tell because, I mean, for instance, ibogaine is a prescription medicine here. It's completely accepted. It's very hard to find a doctor that'll prescribe it for you, but it's fully accepted medically, and there are a number of retreat centers you can go to, and there's actually a study being done in a city called Dunedin that maps they're part of, they're doing an observational study of this trial that's being done. And so we are actually quite open to it. I mean, it's, I've found it hard to find somebody to debate with, because most people tend to either have never heard what you have to say, or they already know what you're talking about. You know, that's been my experience, and maybe that's just been my manifesting of wanting people around me, you know.
Is it true that, you know, Matt Bowden, right?
Yeah.
Yes. I mean, he told me, I can't quite believe this, that if you want to market a new drug, a new recreational drug in New Zealand, you can pay for a clinical trial. You can demonstrate that it's not harmful, and you're free to sell it. Is that true?
More or less. I mean, we have...
Wow.
You know,
so there are a number of synthetic cannabinoids on the market that are completely legal.
There's a number, but they also are trying to make them illegal as quick as they can. And I mean, some of them are horrible. You know, I tried a particular one a few months ago, and it was just, you know, the intellectual feel was a lot like marijuana, but you know, it was an incredibly elevated heart rate. Brief muscle spasms, slightly blurred vision.
That's not good.
Quite altered sense perception, where things would smell quite different, or I would hear things differently to how they're actually occurring. And it was just not very fun. It was just really kind of boring. But there is a number. What we do have a lot of here is synthetic, orally active drugs. So, you know, something that's mimicking the effects of MDMA, or something that's mimicking the effects of ketamine or methadrone, or any number of these kind of party drugs that people, you know, like.
Right, the 2C series and all that.
Yeah, that type of thing. Yeah. And the other thing that we have here I'm sure this is the case all over the world, but it seems to be quite popular here, is salvia extract. Is quite popular here. You know, do you remember the shop that we were in after the lectures that you did in Auckland? That shop, they have there's just a huge glass cabinet, probably about 6 feet, of all these different things you can get, where they have salvia droppers and salvia, you know, extract, and then leaves and all of these different things. It seems to be a really popular thing here because it has a grounding in some cultural structure, you know, with the Mazatecs who used salvia. It seems to be really popular for that reason.
The way it's taken, I mean, it's isn't traditional.
No, not at all. And
I'm surprised it's so popular, because most people don't like that much.
Exactly. I mean, I went through about a year where I had very meticulous uses of all of the drugs that I took that year, where I kept diaries of the dosage, where I got it from, what it was chemically, the effect that it had, what I expected, and then what actually happened. And salvia was the only one where I didn't want to write anything afterwards. I didn't want to say anything about it, because it was just so kind of frightening. I wanted to just kind of forget about it and give it up as a bad job, almost. You know, I'm very interested in doing the traditional way, though, the chewing of the fresh leaves rather than the extract.
Well, it's different when you do it that way. It's quite different.
Have you had experience with it, personally?
Once, yeah.
How was that?
It was much more stretched out, you know, for one thing. Obviously, it was like an hour.
Okay.
It was hard to describe. It did have some of the qualities of when you smoke it. It had that quality of being in a membrane, which you sometimes get. There was a great deal of body distortion, and my own experience with salvia is very limited, but the few times that I have taken it, that's been my impression. It's almost entirely something about the distortion of my body image. It's about the body. It's about my mind is unaffected. I'm like, I seem to be melting into the floor.
Yeah.
You know, okay, this is what's happening. But as far as my ego, it's not sure. disturbed, you know. And it's.
But as far as I understand, it's chemically very different to the other psychedelics, isn't it? It actually attaches to a very different receptor
in the brain. Oh, yeah. The kappa opiate receptor.
Yeah. This is very different to the.
It's not a serotonin.
No.
It's not really a psychedelic under the strict definition. It affects the kappa opiate receptor, and not only does it affect it, but it is more selective for that receptor than any other known compound.
Right, right. Even more so than your morphines and heroines and that sort of thing.
Oh, well, those aren't selective. Those hit.
Sorry.
There are basically three kinds of opiate receptors now. I mean, there may be subtypes now, but the mu, the kappa, and the delta. Morphine hits mainly the mu, but spills over into kappa and delta. The mu receptor is the receptor of the euphoria and analgesia and addiction, obviously, reinforcing all those things. Yeah. Kappa is the receptor of, you know, kappa opiate agonists are dysphoric, you know. Right. They're, and that's what salvia is, you know. Yeah, but some people like it, and it's the most potent psychoactive substance known in nature, which is interesting. Yeah, it doesn't contain nitrogen. That's the thing.
Right.
Most psychoactive substances contain nitrogen. Cannabinoids being an exception to that. And salvia is a diterpene. It doesn't contain, any nitrogen. But it's active at LSD levels, you know.
Right, okay.
50 micrograms is a threshold dose of salvinol.
That's interesting. I didn't know it's quite that powerful.
It is.
Yeah. That's very interesting. Very interesting. So how do you feel about LSD? I mean, it doesn't... For a few years, I was a little bit kind of elitist about this, where I sort of had in my mind that, you know, LSD is not natural, it's synthetic, it's... or at least a chemical modification of something natural, at the very least. And so it must not have the same kind of quality of being a window into some other, you know, you're using the word dimension, into some other room where there may possibly be information we don't already have or any of those things. How has your experience with LSD been versus the plant-based hallucinogens and, you know?
Well, you know, it's hard to make a distinction. I think LSD has its place. I think it's great. It doesn't get me to those visionary, you know, dimensions that psilocybin will or some of these other things, but it gets me into a really interesting sort of cognitive space.
Yeah.
I think LSD has got its place, and I think it's almost archetypal, you know. It is a semi-synthetic, it's true, but it's very close to some natural synthetics. And it was, the temptation is to let it join the pantheon, if you will, because of its historical position and the odd way it was discovered. It was almost like, you know, certainly not a scientific attitude, but the idea that... you know, certain things erupt into history at certain times. Maybe LSD had to come on the scene. You know, it was like if there wasn't an Albert Hoffman, someone else would have discovered it. It was time, you know, and it emerged in the middle of one of the darkest periods of the 20th century. And, it changed everything, no doubt about it.
Absolutely.
It changed everything. So I bless LSD. It's very good. It's a good thing. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I've always had very good experiences. I've just been a little bit biased, you know, where I've sort of credited it as more of a party experience than maybe mushrooms, which I find very hard to take if I'm not alone. You know, it's
right. Well, if you, it's a dose thing too. I mean, I think most of the LSD out there is now, what's out there is probably fairly low doses. Yeah,
maybe what I understand is
50 well. To 100 micrograms. But if you get up to 250 to 500, it's powerful. I don't normally take it that much. My main problem with LSD is it just lasts too long.
Right. It is a big undertaking, that's for sure.
It doesn't fit into our always rushed lifestyle like these other things do.
So that's one dichotomy I actually have with the cactus hallucinogens, the San Pedro and Peruvian torch and all of these, is that a very good dose of that have been, one very good specific dose that I had of mescaline was probably the most important psychedelic experience I've had so far. And I'm quite young. I'm only 22. I've got a long time to go, and I've not encountered DMT yet, which is probably going to be the big one. But it lasted about 15 hours.
Yeah. You know,
and this was absolutely exhausting. I mean, obviously, I came out of it with some great insights and everything else, but it was very, very hard to, you know, arrange my life in a way that would allow for this experience to really just unfold itself comfortably. You know, it was very hard to avoid having to deal with the physical reality, you know, during that time. And right. I'm wondering if maybe that has something to do with the fact that it's, I mean, as far as I understand, it's actually part of the amphetamine family, mescaline.
It's a phenethylamine, yeah, like amphetamine, right? Amphetamine is amphetamine means literally alpha methyl phenylethylamine. It's a simple modification of phenethylamine, and mescaline is 3,4,5 trimethoxy phenethylamine without the alpha group on the side chain. Yeah. So and that's what Shulgin did. That was his first breakthrough. One of the first things he made was he took mescaline molecule, put an alpha methyl group on the alpha carbon. You know, you've got the ring, you've got 1, 2, 3, a 2-carbon tail with the nitrogen on it, right? And that's the ethylamine part of it. If you put a methyl group on that first carbon in from the nitrogen, it's hard to describe this without drawing pictures. But
I'll put some images up when this goes up.
Then you have the amphetamine analog. So if you take mescaline, you simply make the amphetamine analog by adding that alpha carbon. You increase the potency by a factor of 10.
Right, right.
So it's still a hallucinogen, and it's still mainly serotonin. You know, I mean, even mescaline basically works on serotonin, but you add that component. And what you're doing is you're blocking the deamination of that removal of that nitrogen by adding that methyl group. That blocks the deaminase. That blocks, essentially, it blocks monoamine oxidase, you know, which is the enzyme that would detoxify that. So all of these things like DOM is essentially a mescaline analog. It's got the amphetamine on it's got the methyl on the alpha carbon, and on the ring, all he did was move the methoxy group from the 3 to the 2 position, and substitute a methyl group for the methoxy group on the 4 position, and you've got a substance that's now active at a milligram dose.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Anyway, we could talk all this chemistry all night. You know,
I love it. I love it. Don't get me wrong. What for you is the most interesting psychedelic? I mean, whether that's culturally or chemically or your personal experience, whichever it is, what has kind of had what's grabbed you the most and made you sort of want to learn and understand?
Well, I think two things. I mean, I like the tryptamines, and I think that psilocybin and ayahuasca are really my two main ones. I think DMT is very interesting. It is definitely something that should be synthetic on DMT. Everybody's map, yeah, yeah, or natural DMT isolated. But the oral, the in, you know, the smoked form of it, not orally active form, the abrupt form of it. Yeah. I think it's very interesting, but I think it's hard to bring something back from that. Mm. You know? And that's why I like psilocybin, because it's more, or ayahuasca, because it's DMT, but it's more stretched out over time. So you have a chance to integrate it. With the DMT, smoked DMT, it's, you know, it's like, it's 10 minutes, it's 15 minutes of utter, amazing, transcendent, bizarre, beautiful, all those things, and you come back and you're babbling, and, you know, and you can't really say what happened, because as soon as you come down, you're forgetting it, you know. And also, as soon as you come down, you're trying to box it into some kind of a linguistic box, you know, because the experience is so overwhelming and so non-linguistic that it's a natural impulse to try to just explain this. The power of the experience is so numinous that you're starting to spin out, you know, you're starting to defuse it almost before you even get over it, you know. But you should put it on your map. In Australia, you must have the opportunity.
I just have not spent any long periods of time there. You know, I've only been there for sort of like a week here and a week there to see family and that kind of thing.
Have you taken ayahuasca?
No. It's incredibly hard to find here. The last example I know of someone who tried to bring in any ingredients for it was they had Mimosa hostilis root bark shavings. They'd imported 18 kgs of root bark shavings, and they were charged with importing 18 kgs of DMT. So I think most people really try to avoid that, you know, trying to get plants into the country here, which is really, really unfortunate. But I intend to travel a lot in the next sort of 5 years or so, and I expect to spend a lot of time in the Amazon. I expect to go to Central Africa and
do the above. Have you been to Peru?
No. I was born in England, and other than New Zealand, the only other place I've been is Egypt.
Well, Egypt. Well, that's one place I haven't seen, but
Egypt was
There's a lot of places. I'll bet Egypt is amazing. I don't know if you know, I'm helping organize an ayahuasca retreat in August.
Yeah.
Should you be interested? There's actually, we just had a space open up, so you could come.
I am incredibly interested. It was the first thing that came to mind.
Really?
Yeah, it was. It was the first thing that came to mind. You had emailed me about it, and I was just so excited, especially because, you know, the first section of it is visiting the megalithic sites and everything. Mm-hmm. And that was, the entire thrust of my research until about a year and a half ago was the megalithic stuff, and that was why I was in Egypt. You know, I was there with Graham.
And so you were in Egypt with Graham?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Oh, that would be fantastic.
Well, yeah. It was absolutely amazing. And, I mean, that was why it was so easy for me to come to the conference last year, was because, you know, I already knew Graham and his wife. And that was actually how I – do you remember you and I and Mitch ended up having lunch on the Sunday? Mm-hmm. By coincidence of where everybody was at the time. And I wouldn't have actually been able to go to that, except that Santha and I became very good friends when we were in Egypt. We were there for about a week, and, you know, we were living on this boat on the Nile and everything. And we became very good friends, and when she saw me at the conference, she said, "Are you coming tomorrow?" And I said, "No, I only knew that there was a second day a few days before I left Auckland, so I wasn't able to get the money together or actually organise getting a ticket." And she said, "Oh, nonsense," and grabbed Doron and just said, "This guy's got to come in tomorrow," and blah blah blah. And so that was why I was able to actually be there and meet you and Mitch and sort of start off my big thrust on this.
Well, that's excellent. Yeah.
And those sorts of synchronicities are what lead me to believe, you know, this is something that I really need to be doing currently.
I love both of them. Graham and Santa are wonderful people. We had a great time hanging out together.
Yeah.
In Australia. And then we were at Ayahuasca.
Right.
In February. And again, so I'm trying to get him. He's going to be in the States in November, and I'm trying to organize some events for him here.
Yeah, that'd be amazing.
Yeah, that would be very good.
I thought kind of, darn, you know, the trip that you're doing in Peru is in August, and he's doing a trip in Peru in October with Brian Forster, and I thought, you know, if those two had happened to sync up, that would have been pretty incredible.
That would have been incredible. Yeah, his travel schedule is exhausting.
Oh, yeah. He's just had his hip replacement as well, and he's still just, you know, going just along.
Ranking on, man.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. Amazing human being, that one. The amount of love that those two have in themselves is absolutely incredible and a real inspiration to me.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I do very much hope to come along on this trip in August. I mean, it's something that I felt really drawn to. I mean, it happens to have both of the aspects that my entire life's work seems to be moving towards, you know, it's the psychedelic indigenous thing, which I hope to be doing.
Did I send you the information?
Yeah.
I did, okay. Yeah, I won't send it to you now, then. I can pop you the files, but you've got it.
No, yeah, well, you want me early on, and... Yeah, I really, really hope to be able to come to that. It's just...
You know, Chris Coughlin and his wife are coming.
Okay.
And Tom Brown is coming.
Right. I'll talk to them then. Yeah, definitely. I mean, I've been in touch with Tom a couple of times since you guys were here. So, yeah, it'll be pretty good to know some people as well. it's always fun to turn up in a foreign country with no one to know.
I was hoping that Matt might come, but he's got an opening or something that same week, so he's not going to come. But I'm hoping that he will come down at some other time. I may be going back in November because... there's some interest in this ayahuasca clinic idea, and there are a couple of people who are Hefter supporters who may want to invest in this this idea. So I'm trying to arrange a meeting for them to come down and take a look at it. They can't. One of them is coming to the event. The other guy, Cody Swift, he's not able to come this time. So we'll see what happens.
Yeah, it's very... good looks all around, really. You know, just getting people involved and getting more of it happening as well. You know,
I think
just because of the way that our culture works, when you have figureheads like yourself or Graham or someone like that talking about this type of thing and running clinics and running tours and et cetera, et cetera, it gets a lot of people interested, you know, and it gets a lot of people's interest piqued where they'll... you know, make the effort to go and find out the information, raise the money, and actually go down and do it.
And do it, yeah. Plus, for us, it beats working, right? I
mean, yeah, absolutely. I mean, that was one of the things that I was really surprised about with, I'm not sure if you know Robert Bouval, who Graham's worked with a lot on with the Egypt mysteries and stuff.
Yeah, I don't know him, but I know who he is, yeah.
It was his tour in Egypt, and Graham was sort of the guest... you know, sort of lecturer and guide. And, you know, Robert does 3 or 4 of these a year, and you know, that's his job. He gets to just go around Egypt talking about cool things and having fun with interesting people. You know, it's much better than working at a factory or something.
Well, I do that. That's what I do, essentially.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I've got a gotta buck up though and get some more gigs going. We were gonna teach a course in Peru this summer, and that fell through. So now I've got this retreat.
Yeah.
Possibly a course at Ayahuasca in January.
Right, January 2014.
Yeah.
I'd be very interested in that. So keep me
Plants and Human Affairs, you'd be interested in that?
Yeah, I'd definitely be interested in that.
We're trying to, we're all set to go, but it's proving problematic with the airfares, you know, which are expensive, and we can't get decent group rates.
Sure.
Of course, in your case, the airfare is just completely over the top, but, you know, you'd have to deal with that. But we're hoping to offer this course, and it will be a credit course, and it'll be taught by Luna and myself.
Oh, right. So.
That would be good.
That'd be brilliant. I mean, I didn't mention Luna earlier, but he's also someone who's been incredibly important bringing Pablo Amarengo to the West and getting anthropology involved in the study of psychedelics as well.
Yeah, very important. That was a big catalyst, I think, for the whole ayahuasca tourism phenomenon. Was really, it was Pablo's paintings that brought attention to this.
Yeah.
And, you know, Pablo went to the environmental summit in Rio in 1992 and got some kind of a medal for this.
Oh, really? Wow.
So, yeah. I mean, he should have shared it with Eduardo.
Sure.
He did, but that's okay.
Sure.
You know, Eduardo doesn't worry about that.
Well, yeah.
But, yeah. So I think I'm going to have to go.
Yeah. No, that's fine. It's been absolutely incredible talking to you. And I'm sure we'll talk again at some point soon, and hopefully I'll see you in August as well.
If you can, absolutely. We'd love to have you. It's going to be a interesting bunch of folks down there.
Absolutely. I can imagine so.
We're trying to select the... call us elitist, maybe so, but we're trying to make sure that all the people who come will be as interesting as me and the curandero and all that. I mean, we're going to have some good interpersonal dynamics, I think. So, a beautiful place, can't beat it.
Yep.
So, save your money and come.
Yeah, that's basically what my life is based around right now, is getting that together so that I can come on this trip. It's very good. All right, Dennis, thank you very much for talking to us. We've covered a hell of a lot in a relatively short space of time. I'm sure we'll talk again. I'm sure I'll see you again. And good luck. Good luck.
All right, thank you.
No problem.
Yeah, good luck to you, Amadeus. It was a pleasure.
Thank you very much. See you later, Dennis.
Bye-bye.
See you later.